because you know, you see monuments with people sitting down and you're, am I not the man and the mother? So I walk into the meeting and I see this sketch, the first sketch is of Irish lyrics. I said, you're telling me a monument to resistance? And you have a man sitting on his ass. So, I said, that's not what happened. The guys rose up, they took their compasses and they took their torches and they burned the place down, 7 of the 11 times in the negative point, and you have this guy sitting on the outside. So, they withdrew that sketch and they got another sketch. So that one comes in, you know, the guy has a torch in the hand, he has a compass in his hand, boy, he's putting torch on and compass through. Went back to the officials. The Labour Party was in power. They see the torch of Marlborough there, no, 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 we don't want this money. Back to the drawing board. So the monument you saw there was the third monument to this 14th that started us as honoring the soldiers. But what we said it was, no, we won't have to the brigands or the guerrillas, we'll have it to emancipation. So it became, it evolved into an emancipation. And that moment was a comprehensive school, the building was in the government warehouses, and we say, I prefer not giving up on that. But that monument is built there somewhere. And I think it's a reflection. We don't teach our history, we build our monuments, we never know. It's a sad reflection on the people who govern us. I'm very sad about it.
Oh, Mr. Williams, thank you very much. Dr. Williams, thank you very much, because you actually reinforced everything I was saying. What you actually pointed out, that there was even more contestation than I actually thought. I came across talk of the flambeau, but I could not find a sketch. So because I had no documentary evidence, I decided to leave it out of the process.
Final.
Dr. Philip Jones, it sort of occurred to me that in looking at the monument, there seems to be like an experience of the one in Nams, which seems fairly documentary, say a cell, something that was actually used in slavery. On the other hand, we've seen also the monuments that are artistic creations. In my thinking, I think that, you know, there ought to be an aspect of memory that's accurate to guide us in how we live going forward. Now, my question to you is, do you think that creating monuments as purely artistic creations as opposed to something representative and documentary like a cell on actual slave ship or something, so do you think there's a danger that it can actually corrupt that aspect of memory over time that ought to be accurate because of the freedom associated with artistic creation?
I think there's a danger with any type of monument because of what the monument does. It always sits on somebody's memory. Always, no matter what it is that you do. In Nantes, it was not about slavery, it was about France's role in abolition of slavery. In the UK, the International Slavery Museum, where the face of the boat with on the caves with the people in it, that slavery museum was in the basement of the building. And when the people of African descent in the UK started to rile up and say, how come they're part of the historical narrative as well, they got in there. The museum moved from the basement to the fourth floor. In the one I showed in Holland, in the Netherlands, people who had moved from Suriname to Holland were demanding that this thing be put up because they are part of the historical narrative of the Netherlands. They were not in there before. Somebody called it emplacement. We demand that be part of that history. Almost every time you put up a monument, you sit on something. One time in Ghana, this massive edifices, right? The huge, very, very big edifices. And when you speak to a Ghanaian, even professionals, with heritage practitioner, refers to them unconsciously, in my mind, as European forts. They distance themselves from it. No class in Ghana does any child talked about. I did the research, I have the curriculum. Unless it has changed in the last couple of years, you know how these things happen. There's nobody in Ghana who's talking about slavery. What they talk about slavery is slavery across the ocean. And there are people, grandparents, not great grandparents who make slaves. I was interviewing a gentleman, a heritage practitioner, he was big in on the GMBB. And when I spoke with him, the beauty of the interviews is that when people get comfortable, they speak. That's why I love anthropology and that type of finding data. He began to talk about slavery. Those people speak about slavery. What slavery are you talking about? And he slips. He's like, but my grandfather had slaves. I was like, waiting for the shoe to drop. Yes, he had slaves for his cocoa plantation. And I'm like, oh boy, this is going to be heavy. Like, they're now members of the family. They integrated into the family. And then he takes a breath and says, well, unless one of them decides to become an upstart. I'm like, really? They remember that they're enslaved. Today, they are members of the family as long as they behave. The memory of slavery is there. But people are so busy making money off the trauma of transatlantic slave trade that it is not convenient or economical. I began to write a paper some time ago about the role of heritage industrial complex, that's what they call it. It's only the neoliberal requirements of developing countries has forced them to start specific heritages that are marketable, not necessarily heritage that is useful to the people. They are rich in it. I'll give an example of my experience in Ghana. I walk up to the fort. This young gentleman comes up to me and he starts talking. And I've not learned everything I needed to learn as an anthropologist, but I was learning very, very quickly. He gave me a he asked what my name was, and he told me his name. I went into the fort. When I came out, the first person who approached me was him. He gave me a shell. The shell had my name on it. Welcome, Akwaba, to Ghana. And then he's standing there looking at me. It's a transaction. I quickly got on and said, no, I wasn't. He said, then buy this. I bought the thing. Remember, I'm a diasporan African. Descendants cross the water. What began to occur to me was the sites where the slaves were stored before shipping was still exploiting diaspora Africans. When I told him that I got buying, he said something which put everything together. I said, yeah, that's why you bought a ticket to Ghana. This is an emotional experience when I'm relating and feeling. It upset me because I quickly realized what was happening. This selling of heritage ain't no different from what was happening before. And who is the next white man? The same people. That fort and these forts are on top of the memory of slavery in Ghana. Right across the Caribbean, they're on top of something, they're on top of different things. Every time you choose to put up a monument, you choose to forget. And that's the point I'm trying to make. We have to be careful what we remember and how we remember, because we inherently need to forget. And I'm not saying forgetting is a bad thing, because sometimes we need to. We all are human beings. If we look at our memories, some of them we don't want to have to deal with at all. Some societies wouldn't want to do that. I'm not trying to be prescriptive here. I'm just looking at the process and trying to illuminate, if you will, a process that we're all participating in, but I'm not necessarily conscious of.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ajiman, for facilitating this discussion. I know it has to continue, but unfortunately, we have to come to an end. We want to thank our online viewers as well for participating. And as this is our inaugural lecture, we would like to make a special presentation to Dr. Fulgens for being our first speaker, and we would invite the chair of the Board of South African Ways Community College to make this presentation. close, I would like to invite, as Mr. Lucien had said earlier, where the genesis of this was, in the vice principal principal's office. So to make a closing remarks, please have you welcome Dr. Mercy.
Please a round of applause for us.
OECS as well. To my left is a young gentleman who's out of uniform, but he's actually a student here at the college, a very reliable student. He is a digital media student, and my right hand is the media club, Mr. Omar Pompey, for a We also want to thank Ms. Janelle Knight of the ITS department and the entire ITS department. Mr. Ross, the head of the team, was here earlier and was assisted by Mr. Lincoln Louie. If you were here earlier, you know how passionate Mr. Emmanuel is about his e-learning, live streaming. He drives everybody crazy. So I'm showing what we went through this afternoon. The setting that you're in actually now serves as our reading room for the library. And we have seriously displaced it. You wouldn't know that. In all the tables, you can still see these are workstations. You see the bookshelves. So thank you so much to the staff of the Hunter G. Kaswa Library for allowing us the use of this room. And we inconvenienced them so much because it was the room that was most ready for our live streaming. It had the ports and all of the other technical stuff that I can't speak to, readily available here, and it would have made it easier. For the 200 plus viewers that I understand joined us this evening. So there are more things to come, and I'm so happy for that. So thank you to Mrs. Kathy Bushman-Diamond, our AV technician, who's also associated with the library, Mr. Garvin McDonald, who is always devoted to our events and who we can't do without. Thank you so much, Garvin, for being here at this time. We know how far you have to go. Thank you to the Office of the Vice Principal. Not to interrupt my time, who's at times. A little bit unusual, bear with us.
I'd like to issue a challenge. We always start things and we continue. So the challenge to the team is to sustain this. Thank you.
I think that challenge this time is the challenge to be small.
Yes, we do intend to do so. So let me get to my important thanks and then I'll address it
again. To our moderator, Mr. our interlocutor. I like that word. Mr. Solomon Anderson. Even after retirement, he is willing to assist us here at the college, and he does continue to have a few classes with our students, so we're very happy for Mr. Ajman's experience. Our esteemed inaugural speaker, Dr. Winston Pullman. And I'm not sure whether he has been congratulated on earning his PhD, so on behalf of the college, Dr. Pullman, let me say congratulations. We are extremely proud of you. We will support you when you get in trouble with the only people that you keep referring to, but we think it's necessary. And I know I can pledge the vice principal's support and his voice. So thank you so much, Dr. Pullman. And of course, to you, our audience. Without you, our online audience and our in-house audience, without you, we would not have a lecture. So thank you so much for coming out tonight. We do pledge continuity. Our plan is actually to have this once a month. And today was our feeler to see how Wednesday night works for persons. So at the end, we will get some feedback and plan accordingly, but we have a list of presenters already, and we invite persons from the public, areas of expertise that they are willing to share, to please get in touch with us. Just speak to us up to Ms. Henry and the Vice Principal's office, and we'll filter down to us and we will program accordingly. So thank you so much for being here, for your assistance, for your attendance, and for your participation. And we invite you to some refreshments after, and to our online audience. Maybe you can come to the tea with us. Thank you for staying with us. Good night, everyone. Get home safely.